To think that I could not go on, and life was nothing but an awful song. But now I know the meaning of true love. Yes, I'm leaning on the everlasting arm. If I can see it, then I can do it. If I just believe it, there's nothing to it. Oh, I believe I could fly. I believe I can touch the sky. Think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I was on the verge of breaking down. Yes. Sometimes silence, it can seem so loud. There are miracles in life I must achieve. But first I know it starts inside of me. If I can see it, I can do it. If I just believe it, there's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. Think about it every night. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly.
Washington, D.C. and surrounding metropolitan area. Good morning. Welcome to the Wednesday. Yes, I said Wednesday. You know I'm Wednesday now. I moved from Friday to Thursday, Thursday to Wednesday. So here I am, 10 o'clock on Wednesday. So welcome to the Wednesday edition of In Our Voices. I'm your host, your producer, always your word warrior, Nkenge Toure. And I'm delighted to be here with you all this morning. It is a bright, sunny, hot, want to be in the Caribbean, want to be somewhere kind of day. You might think, well, why would you want to be in the Caribbean? It's hot there, but the humidity is different. And that breeze blowing off the water is different. But here we are, and it's all good. And as I always say, any day above dirt is a good day, because if you weren't above dirt, you wouldn't even know what kind of day it is. So that means you get chance after chance after chance. Every day, you get a new chance. So any day above dirt. So we are delighted to be here. Everyone knows, or most of you know, that it is Black Music Month, thus declared by our former president, Jimmy Carter. And it has now evolved into African American Music Appreciation Month, as defined by our current president, Barack Obama. So whether we say Black Music Month or African American Music Month, it's all the same. It's about our history, our herstory with music. It's about appreciation and acknowledgement of our music. So you know, a couple weeks ago I did blues to take a look at Black music, and we focused on I believe it was Victoria Spivey and Sippy Wallace and Ida Cox, and it was very I felt it was a very interesting show, and it was women who were, you know, the 20s, the 30s, the 40s, and we got a chance to play some of their music from those race records from the OK label, which was the label that they put all the Black music on. Okay, and we also, all of the women that we spoke about have passed on and are sharing their music from their place above. So I thought that we would now include in this some jazz, or, you know, kind of various forms of that. And so I'm real excited because, and I got the suggestion from Lucy Murphy, why not focus on local women? So that was an exciting idea. And so with the assistance of Lucy, I'm giving you your props, Lucy, with the assistance of Lucy Murphy, was able to get in touch with Roberta Washington and Marcella Fitzgerald, okay, also with, excited to have with us also Kenitra Miller, who is the director of Afro Blue. Are you with us?
I am.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And Roberta and Marcella, good morning.
Good morning.
Glad to have you all here in the studio, and glad to have you with us, Kenitra, by phone. Appreciate that very much, because we played a lot of, you know, trying to catch up with this sister, and I didn't actually get to talk to you, Kenitra, until last night, and you were so gracious and said, oh, yes, of course. You know, I dig WPFW, and I would be happy to be a part of this interview. So thank you.
My pleasure.
So I'm going to start like this. Now that I have introduced Roberta and Marcella, and now that I've introduced you, I'm going to play a little bit from, well, let's go with Roberta and Marcella first. Play a little bit from Fritz and the Duchess, and then which is called Music Is Enough, and we'll ask her just what does that mean, music is enough. You know, I like music, but, you know, I also need oxygen and other stuff. No, stop, let me stop. You know, so
good point.
So we're going to do that, and then we're going to follow up with something from Afro Blue, and then we're going to come back, and we're going to talk with these women, and I don't want any of you to go anywhere. You can sit right where you are and make a phone call, call a couple of friends, and tell them to tune in and get some knowledge and some information about some of our local artists. So I'm going to give this to the sign to our ever able engineer, Michael, and he's going to do it.
If you're feeling like you're lonely, or you're in that nasty mood, you gotta get up and go out to a place where the music's got the groove. When you step into the party, you will know without a doubt that we share all the common fact of life and it's known the world about. Yeah, groove, once you get through it, move, groove, that you can use in my groove. If you love music, sing groove, just stop the music. Yeah, groove, once you get through it, move, groove, that you can use in my groove. If you love music, sing groove, just stop the music. Music, it's enough where you are.
Afro Blue are the cool kids of jazz. They take this really highbrow version of music and find a way to make that accessible for the everyday Joe.
I loved Afro Blue from the second they took the stage. They've got chops, they've got loads of personality, and I relate to them because they're students of music.
My favorite performance was American Boy. I love the way that they did that. It sounded good, it looked good, it was good.
Okay, high praise for Afro Blue. We're going to get a chance to hear Change Gonna Come, which is a piece that from them that I like. Now, what you heard at the top from Marcella and Roberta from their CD Music Is Enough is you heard Music Is Enough as arranged by Marcella. And the last piece on that, which is number 10, is an instrumental version of that. But this is just to wet your chops a little bit to, you know, get you a little bit excited about Roberta and Marcella and to get you excited about Afro Blue. So, having said that, and wet your chops a little bit, and we will hear a little bit more music from them. I want to just kind of get into this, and I'm going to start with you, Roberta. You were raised in D.C. and attended Coolidge High.
Yes, I did.
You attended Coolidge High School.
I did.
Where you were in the youth orchestra?
D.C. Youth Orchestra, yes, under the auspices of Lynn McLean.
Wow. Okay. So those of you who went to Coolidge High, I'm sitting here with one of your people. Okay. And I want to ask you, Roberta, did you grow up in a musical household?
Yes. As a matter of fact, my mother was a musician, and it was rather unique. I'll just say briefly that she wanted to be a dancer, actually, and you know, in the early 1900s, it wasn't proper, according to my grandmother. And instead, she bought a piano and said, learn to play it. You won't be dancing in this century, so to speak. Mm. And actually, that didn't turn out poorly. She did a good job with it. And I understand that she gave concerts up until she was 18 and then ran away from home.
She
wanted
to take the piano with her.
Yeah, no. She left it there. It's sort of an albatross, but she left it there. And so, yes. And when we were raised, we had music in the household all the time, certain times a day on Saturday. And Sundays, we listen to Broadway shows, and sometimes in the evening, we listen to jazz. In the early part of the day, like once the school was out, we'd listen to Mozart and this and that. She had a vast variety of things she just continued to expose us to. And I think that was a good thing. That wound up being a very good thing.
Are you the only, like, brother or sister in your family who is
musically? Yes and no. Again goes that, because my sister really did want to dance, and so there was just the two of us, and she took dance mostly, and I took music mostly, although some of the deals made with Mom, well, you can take snare drum, but you gotta take modern dance. I don't want you to be too boyish.
Okay,
I want you to be graceful.
She was trying to balance you all out.
She was trying to make me graceful. You know, that's a little clumsy too. When I was
that's out of that time period of the idea of what women were and they could do and couldn't do.
That's right.
You know, Kenitra, I know I'm messing up your name again. I'm so just let me keep working on it. You know, my tongue is dyslexic.
Kenitra,
and I wrote it down phonically. I wrote down Kenitra. Okay, but I'm working on it. Okay.
Yeah, either one.
So while working on it, Kenitra, I know that you grew up in Kansas, and but ultimately you made your way here through a lot of other stop offs and et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to ask you, you know, in your early, did you come from a family with a, did you grow up in a musical household or what?
I will say, just before I answer that question, I want to say hi to Roberta.
Oh, hey, Kenitra, how are you?
Yeah, Roberta and I know each other, and I was listening to the beginning of the recording, and I thought, Roberta also plays a mean disc.
There you go.
She can make a good rhythm instrument out of anything, so it's great to hear your voice, Roberta.
Oh, it's great to be connected with you again, Kanetra.
I did not grow up in a very musical household, per se. My oldest brother had taken some piano lessons. My oldest sister took some piano lessons, and she learned to play gospel music in church. Mm. And then I took lessons. And I'm the youngest of 8 siblings. And neither
really?
My mother or my father were musical.
So it was just in you.
Yeah, it was one of those things. You know, my mother tells the story of when I was 4 years old. The way that she got me into piano lessons was she said I could pick out songs by ear. And she heard me playing something that my brothers and sisters had been singing, some song they had learned in school. And she asked my oldest sister if she had taught me how to play that, and she told her no. And so that's when she got me, and I started taking piano lessons
okay.
at the age of 4.
She realized that you had something special. That's, wow, that's incredible. I want to ask you, Marcella, since you're sitting there in all your maroon, so I want to ask you the same question. You did not, you came to D.C. You were not originally from D.C. You moved here from New York. And I want to ask you the same question. Did you come out of a musical family? I mean, how did you find yourself where you are?
Well, actually, I came from a more academically
inclined
mm-hmm. family mm-hmm. of 12, in which I'm 11. But we had 12 of us, so we had a lot of dancing in the 70s, and I grew up around my sisters playing all the, you know, latest phono records. And I've always been musical myself,
okay.
not necessarily, you know, from the family. As a matter of fact, I was more thought about as the different one since I was musical.
Mm-hmm.
But we all
mm-hmm.
still are very musical together. We sing, we pretend to be in groups, and it was a lot of fun growing up musically.
I'm going to ask actually all three of you, you know, in a sort of brief way, I'm going to ask all three of you if you could just talk a little bit about your early musical background and experiences. I know that you all of you attended school to enhance your musical abilities mm-hmm. and increase your musical knowledge. So if you could just take a moment to each of you to just say a little bit about that, your journey through school, et cetera, the thing that, you know, kind of shaped you. You know, I took percussions in school. I did this, I did that. You know, so I'm gonna start with you, Roberta, and then I'm gonna go to Kanetra, and then I'm gonna come to Marcella. Okay, so very briefly. And then after that I'm gonna ask Mike to give us a little bit again from each of you.
Mm-hmm. I began studying snare drum in the fourth grade. I tried before then, and nobody would teach me for two reasons. I was a girl, and they said I was too young.
That girl thing always gets in the way.
It does. But in this case, you know, one guy said, well, she can't count to 10, and I stood there and counted to 100. Oh, well, but she's not ready yet. So I met with a lot of that. In fourth grade at John Tyler Elementary School, one of the DC Youth Orchestra teachers used to go to schools and set up bands and teach students and blah, blah, blah. And I'm grateful for Ann Buxton, that was her name. She used to arrive at the school on a little motor scooter with a little miniature poodle on the back end, leaning with her. That was funny to watch. But she got me started on snare drum, and she taught me what she could. And by that summer, she hooked me into George Clanton And he took it from there. And then after that, I went to Ray Delphi down at Kit's Music Store on Saturday and Sunday. And that continued until I made it to junior high. And I studied with Walter Howe.
What junior high were you at?
Paul Junior High.
Paul. Oh, yeah. My daughters went to Paul.
Really?
Yeah.
Aha. Uh-huh. One yeah. of my old neighbors.
1,000 years ago. Yeah.
Warren Howe was there then teaching. And he told my mother right off the bat, you know, well, she's going to play clarinet. And my mother said, you know, she's been studying snare drums since fourth grade. And here at seventh grade, we're not going to change instruments. And so she informed them that if he wanted to keep his job, he better find a spot for me in the percussion.
So did you, when you went to the D.C. Youth Orchestra?
That was later.
I know, but I'm asking, when you went to that, when you went there, what were your instruments?
Percussion.
They were percussions.
Yes.
Were you afraid, or were you like just really pumped up for that, or what?
I was, but because what
was afraid or was pumped up?
I was only anticipating what the audition would be like because I hadn't quite taken one exactly. But just to bring a closure to Warren Howe's story, he wound up accepting me in percussion, and I turned out to be one of his best percussionists.
Of course.
And with a blessing, I went off to Calvin Coolidge High School. But on the summer of the transfer from junior high to senior high, I took an audition for Lynn McLean. And of course, there was no prejudice involved in his audition. He wanted to know if you could play the instrument. If you could play the instrument, you'd go in an orchestra or the band. And you know, he didn't care if it was a girl playing tuba or guy playing piccolo. He really didn't care. He wanted to expose us all to classical music and teach us to read and just, you know, sort of like being in school.
So
if you learn to read, then you choose what to read.
So you obviously enjoyed your time in the orchestra.
Oh, yeah.
But when you went in, did you go in fully feeling confident or feeling a bit overwhelmed?
I went in feeling that I was going to meet a challenge.
Okay.
And I was up for it.
Well, that's all you can say.
She was
up for the challenge.
Yeah.
What about you, Kenitra? Tell us, you know, kind of share a little bit about your you know, early experience and background, kind of your journey.
Okay. I started off, you know, with music in church, as a lot of kids do, and I was taking piano lessons pretty much from the time I started at 4 all the way through high school, you know, sometimes off and on, as I had to find different teachers. And I sang in the choir at church, you know, gospel choir, during my junior high years. So that's where the vocal part came from.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started to take voice lessons and piano lessons in high school. I did all the, you know, the all-state choir, music competitions, those sorts of things all through high school. And then I went into college at Kansas State University as a music education major.
Kent State?
Yeah, Kansas.
Wow.
Kansas State.
Oh, Kansas State. I thought
yeah.
you said Kent State.
No.
I was like, wow.
Yeah, Kansas State University. And piano was always my main instrument, even though I also sang. And for music education, I focused on vocal music ed. And then I went back to school and got my master's in classical piano performance. And I kind of discovered jazz. I consider myself a late bloomer compared to my students because I discovered jazz my junior year in college. And by accident, I just enrolled in jazz lab for an elective. And I loved it. I was the only pianist in the band, and I had to learn how to play jazz for the big band. And I just bought a bunch of records. That's where I was first introduced to Count Basie.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a record that had Ella Fitzgerald singing on it. And I was hooked.
So I don't think that was an accident. I think the universe elected that for you.
I believe that.
You know, and moved you in, and then from there you were able to, you know, to kind of fill in the blanks. So now, Marcella, quickly,
yes.
Same question.
Well, I grew up in Harlem, USA, singing in the Sunday choir from about 5 years old. When I became a junior high school student, I got in the chorus and went on to be the director of the choir at East Mount Olive Baptist Church in Harlem. And I got into athletics more in high school, so I didn't get into music again until I met Roberta in about 1991. Mm-hmm. And she became my actually first music teacher. Mm-hmm. And she started to teach me theory, you know, and she wanted to prepare me for college. So a couple of years later, I went to Montgomery College, and I studied vocalese with Molly Donnelly, and I majored in percussion. And here I am today, still working at it.
Well, I'm going to, I want to talk to you all a bit about, first of all, what does music mean and what does it represent to each of you? So I'm throwing the question out ahead of time so you can kind of get it in your head. And then secondly, I want to talk about the music scene here in the, around the area. Mm-hmm. You know, as local artists, you know, how is that working out, etc. And I want to ask you a little bit about, for any of you that have traveled outside of the United States, mm-hmm. where it seems that there are places that people truly appreciate jazz, mm-hmm. and pay more attention to it than folk here do. At least that's what it how it often seems. Mm-hmm. So I want to ask you all about the music scene around the metropolitan area, you know, how it is outside of the country, mm-hmm. and what the music means to you. So while you guys, you sisters, you fantastic women players are thinking about that, we're going to go and play something else from Music Is Enough and something else from Afro Blue. And so, folk, you all just be prepared to enjoy this. Okay, what you were hearing First, you heard from Fritz and the Duchess. From "The Music Is Enough," and that was number 10, the 10th track, which was "Music Is Enough" in the instrumental version. So the one you heard at the top was the words with words, etc., and then this last one was the instrumental. And then from Afro Blue, we heard "Change Gonna Come." Okay, so I put these questions out to you all. So, Kenitra, I'm going to start with you. I started asking you all if you could just kind of say something in terms of what music means to you, or what music represents for you.
Music for me is a way of life. Mm-hmm. It encompasses, embodies everything that I do. You know, it feeds me spiritually. It's my employment, you know, it's how I make my living, it's my entertainment. You know, when you go out, it's, for me, it's always to some mm-hmm. music event. It's my therapy, you know, it's what helps, you know, helps you feel better if you don't feel bad listening or singing mm-hmm, or writing. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's how I give back, you know, through my connection with my students, you know, being able to share with them what I know keeps me young. It's how I contribute my community service, whether it's through adjudicating at a festival or teaching music classes, you know, community music classes or whatever. So for me, it's everything, you know, that it's connected to everything that I do.
So, well, then perhaps Fritz and the Duchess are correct when they say music is enough. So I'm going to go to you, Roberta.
You know, I second that emotion. Music for me is life. It's my chosen vehicle of self-expression, and I find as I live, it continues to grow. I started as a percussionist. My mother made me take piano. She said, all musicians need to know how to play piano. I said, yes, mother, because anytime she had a condition like, you study piano or you can't study drums, or you study dance or no drums, I had to say yes to all of it. And it ended up taking modern dance, ballet, tap, piano, anything she said take that she said was relative to what it was I was doing. And I really do love music. I love to compose it. I love to arrange it. I love to be a sideman on somebody else's gig and give all I got. I like to play percussion in various forms. I enjoy playing timpani and orchestral music. I just love music. Most lately, my adventures have taken me to playing with a gamelan ensemble, and that was the ultimate percussion experience.
You want to, for those of us who don't know what a gamelan
is, a gamelan is an assortment of like instruments. The ones that I was exposed to were metallic. They look like pots and pans, sort of, but very well shaped. I mean, this is beautiful. This is coming from Indonesia. I understand that there's a group here in Washington.
And that's what you're doing now?
Most recently, okay. I took a class and completed it in gamelan playing. I played the bunang, which is a set of 12 pots spaced out, and it's amazing. They have numbers and pitches, it's a very wild technique. But I want to see international music come together.
That's why,
you know, in jazz.
One of the reasons I love Brother R.
Brother
R is just,
yes,
he is awesome.
Yes,
you know, with this, with his world music, his knowledge of mm-hmm. it, and you mm-hmm. know,
he was an orchestral player.
So,
yeah.
So yes. And I'm going to let people know that you can get an opportunity to hear Roberta and Marcella and some others on the June
27th
which is
a Friday from 6 to 9.
Mm-hmm, you know, the Jazz Church, Westminster Church, mm-hmm. from 6 to 9 on June the 27th. Okay, and it will be you, and who else will be hanging with you?
Actually, women have not yet met. Janelle, who I've heard marvelous things about, is going to be our keyboardist. Mm-hmm. And I don't know all the women's name. Karen Chappelle, I think.
Rochelle.
Michelle Rice.
Rochelle
Rice. She's going to sing. Uh-huh. There's a few other members. I've not yet memorized the list, but okay. We've not yet met. This time, Marcella won't be with us. because she's going to be out of town on her own gig. But that's we're looking forward to doing that under the auspices of Dick Smith, who has that all set up out there at Westminster.
So people
Church,
remember that
400 High Street Southwest
at on the 27th, Friday the 27th, from 6 to 9.
Tonight.
I know a lot of you are familiar with the Jazz Church, so. Which is also now on Mondays, the Blues Church.
Ah.
So put that on your calendar, and you'll get a chance to see Roberta in the flesh. Now, I want to, because we're going to run out of time soon, I'm gonna skip you, Marcella, on that question, but I'm going to take you first on the next one, okay, which is I want you all to sort of give our listeners a sense of the music scene around the district, or well, I should say around the DMV, around this area. What is the music scene like for local artists, you know, and what is it like for women? You know, I always got to ask, you know, what's up in terms of how things are going for the women. So I'll start with you, Marcella, you know, give us your thoughts on that, and then I'm going to come to you, Kenitra, okay?
I think the music scene in D.C. is a good one. It's usually a family-like situation whenever anyone gets on stage with each other. Everyone meshes, and everyone tries their best to do things, but not to try to get on a negative connotation about things, but...
Truth.
But I could stand to see a lot more women on the stage, and... Even when I've been on stage at some of the scenes, maybe a funeral or memorial or something, and I might go up and bring my percussion bag and play, I would come back down into the audience, and a bunch of women would hover around me and say, "We're so happy. We have at least one representative up there." And I was like, you know, this is really sad. I would like to see more leeway given to women on the whole on the jazz scene in D.C.
Kenitra.
I know that the jazz vocal scene is, I would say, fairly healthy. I am really enjoying the fact that a lot of my former students and some current students are very actively performing in the community. In fact, one of the young lady that Roberta mentioned for the gig coming up at Westminster, Rochelle Rice, is one of my former students from Howard. And so they're very active. Christy Dashiel, who was the soloist on the Change is Gonna Come that we just heard. Jessica Boykin-Settle, Shakira Rogers, who's gonna be at Blues Alley on the 16th of July. And, you know, Sandra Johnson, who's one of my private students, who's gonna be at St. Paul United Methodist on July 18th. So they're kind of all over the place. Playing, we see a lot of Sharon Clark, Lori Williams, you know. I guess if I would say the biggest problem is that now there are a lot of jazz singers and not maybe as many venues so that they're all working as much as they'd like to. You have to kind of spread it around.
That was going to be my question about the venues. Are there enough venues?
Well, there can always be more, you know, and I know that some of my upcoming students are very business-minded. One of my current students, Imani Grace Cooper, she's actually started a jazz series at Sankofa Cafe, which is on Georgia Avenue across the street from Howard University.
Right.
So on Tuesday and Thursday evenings, and she's sold them on that idea, and she's booking a lot of younger artists in there, and they'll sometimes run, you know, a really, you know, late-night kitchen, and that was her brainchild. She put it into action, and so... You know, I think the women are learning to go out there and promote themselves, and they're not just, you know, waiting for the phone to ring anymore. They're out there where the action is, figuring out how can I get in to be a part of what's going on here. And then they're also, if they don't see that there's something going on, they're making something happen.
Now, let me just take a moment to ask you about Afro Blue. Could you just share a little bit about Afro Blue, how you came to direct it, and exactly what it is? You know, do the members in Afro Blue, do they change? Do they stay the same? I mean, what is that that whole process?
Afro Blue has been in existence for 12 years. I started the group my second semester at Howard. And it's all made up of students. And so, yes, it's a revolving group as students graduate and new ones come in.
Mm-hmm.
The group that, you know, we listen to that sang A Change Is Gonna Come and the American Boy and those clips that was on the TV show, they have stayed together, that particular combination, and they have formed their own group, which is now called Traces of Blue. Afro Blue is still a current group at Howard University, which is, you know, performing. We're performing regularly, and we've got some great things coming up that we're working on, a project with Jerry Allen. We're just at the beginning stages of a recording project with Hubert Laws. We're going to do a Christmas CD, and we're recording a holiday special for NPR that will play in December. And so those are some of the things that, you know, we're doing, and that's the group of current students that I still direct.
You all are busy. That's wonderful.
Yeah, we get a chance to do a lot of things, some traveling. We do corporate events. Sometimes we sing for jazz festivals. You know, we did something for the DC Jazz Festival for International Jazz Day. And so, yeah, it's good. It's really good. Keeps me busy.
Now, you know, I want to ask you all about outside of the United States. When I say the music scene, and, you know, you're saying, well, there could be more venues, women are doing better, but we could be doing better in that industry. I'm also wondering, as jazz, you know, do you all feel like jazz is being, that more and more people are recognizing it, appreciating it, embracing it? Mm-hmm. Or do you feel like it's kind of, in certain ways, it's sort of withering away, you know, and there's just like this a small group of committed, dedicated people that love the mm-hmm. music, okay, mm-hmm. and are holding on to it, you know. So, you know, where do you feel like jazz stands here in the U.S., which leads into the other part of my question to you all about, how do you feel that jazz is accepted in other parts of the world? Kenitra, I know you've done quite a bit of traveling outside the United States. So, you know, how you kind of see that. And I know that you, Roberta, have performed in Italy, et cetera. And so from you all, what are your feelings about jazz, the appreciation of it here in the United States? Is it going to die when all of us people who are in our 60s, 70s, and 80s kind of pass on? Is that going to be it? Is it going to be able to hold and maintain or what? And is it better in other places, you know, other parts of Europe, you know, even Japan, which, you know, et cetera? You know, what are you all... what are you all thinking about that? I'll go to Roberta first, and then I'll go to Kenitra, and then to Marcella. And I'm going to have to ask you all to do your edited versions, unfortunately, because we've only got about 10 minutes left or so, and I have a couple of other things definitely to ask you all about.
Let me say that my knowledge of the exterior scene outside of the United States is not from having been there as much as it is looking at the feedback. Apparently Japan has taken a great interest in jazz.
They have.
Because we're starting to get Japanese players playing jazz here. They approach it slightly differently. They sometimes completely copy a famous solo, like a Coltrane solo or a piano solo. They don't see it as an improvisatory they don't see it as an improvisatory thing. They like to prepare it.
Okay, we need to take a real quick break, says
okay.
Mike, and then we'll be right back with
okay.
our guest.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Bill Fletcher, host of Arise. The protection of workers' rights is essential to a just society, and WPFW is your station for jazz and justice. I urge you to support this media treasure by visiting our website at WPFWFM.org to pledge your support.
Okay, and that was Bill Fletcher, and we are back, and this is the Wednesday edition of In Our Voices, and I'm your host, your producer, always your word warrior, Nkenge Toure. My guests are Roberta Washington, Marcella Fitzgerald, and Kenitra Miller, and I'm delighted to have these songbirds and instrumental whizzes, etc., you know, here in the studio and on the phone with us this morning. So, Roberta, you were quickly saying,
We're starting to get a lot. Yeah, that was my last statement. We were starting to get a lot more Japanese players and stuff. A lot of countries are involving themselves. There's always been a good collection of French artists, starting with EDPF, and who knows where that ends. It's gaining more respect outside of the nation's capital rather than inside. The nation capital seems to always be competitive with whatever's new and coming up, and that seems to be what the children embrace, whatever's new and coming up. They're not that steeped in the traditional jazz, but then jazz is evolving. You know, this world music concept is starting to come into jazz, and that brings a lot of other exterior forces with it internationally.
Okay, Kenitra, what are your, you know, because Afro Blue is obviously made up of younger people. So what are your thoughts on this whole, you know, situation in terms of jazz in the United States and what's going on outside of the U.S.?
I spent 6 years teaching in Australia. And I know they have a great respect for jazz there. And it was there that, you know, I really got a chance to see that they recognize jazz as being an African-American art form. And that, you know, by me being there teaching, they just assumed that I knew everything there was to know about the music. It was like, this is your music. I got a chance to really try a lot of things there that I may not have had the opportunity to do had some of my beginning teaching experiences for jazz been here in the U.S. Well, I could experiment pretty much as I wanted to. But I think, you know, what I see happening there with the jazz courses, I also see happening here in the U.S. We have more and more and more schools that are actually offering jazz as a curriculum. I think it's because of that we're going to keep young people connected to jazz, even though there may not be tons and tons of them coming through. The fact that they are learning about jazz, we're connecting them with the older tradition. You've got young artists like Esperanza Spalding, and then someone like Terry Lynn Carrington, who they kind of cross the lines. You know, they don't do just pure jazz, although they do that, but they do a lot of mixtures of jazz with other types of music, with some rap, some soul, R&B, and that's very attractive to the younger people. And so they're selling out, I mean, huge venues and things like that. So that says to me that there are people, and particularly younger people, that are still involved in the music. You know, as I mentioned, a lot of my former students from Howard are out involved in the city. They're performing, and they're attracting younger people. We're getting more and more students who want to come and learn about jazz singing at the course that I'm teaching at Howard. So I think that it's thriving, and it's going to continue as more young people go out as they're, you know, doing their thing.
Now I have to ask you all this, and I'm going to start with, I'm going to start this question with Marcella, because I don't want to think I forgot about her.
No.
Okay. And that is, if artists are not, say, you know, artists being musician, being songstress, whatever, if artists are not under contract with, you know, one of the major labels or something, then how difficult is it to get your projects done and out there? And particularly, how difficult is it to get them done and get them out there if you are female attempting to do this?
Well, because we're in a technological age, it's quite a bit easier to get your stuff out there because we have cdbaby.com. You can do anything you want to do. And if you copyright it and send it in, they will put it on for you. And then there's so many venues online that you can get music out there. Now, to get it into a click, per se, that's a little more difficult because the word click. You know, you have to know someone. Mm-hmm. And if you have a lot of money, you can pay your way into it, of course. I think it's a lot easier these days, but there's some shortcomings as far as women. I don't know why. It's just a position that women have always had, you know, since existence. And we always have to have a special mention as women in anything. So, but like I said, the indie artists now are taking over. So we don't know what's to come, but we can hope for the best.
What are your thoughts, Kenitra, real quick?
I look at someone like Betty Carter, who, you know, was one of the first women to start her own recording label. She had Bet Carr Records. And I think as far as like women having more opportunity to do what they want to do in the world of artists, that we just need to become more business savvy where music is concerned. And I know that there's a young lady in the Washington area. Her name is Amy Borman. Well, she now lives in L.A., but she started the Washington Women in Jazz Festival, which, you know, happens in the month of March. And she's still doing that festival. She comes back from L.A., but, you know, that was there again, one of a brainchild for her, and she figured out how to make it happen and connect with all these venues. So, I mean, unless you can actually afford to pay someone else to do those things for you, you know, along with the fact that we have media and social media for advertisement, you just have to learn how to take care of the business end if you want to be able to compete. And that's where men have always shown themselves to be stronger than women, even though women are definitely capable of doing that and are very, very smart. It's just making the decision that I'm going to do this as opposed to wait on someone else to do it for me.
Now, we're going to get ready. I know I keep saying this, but now I'm really, really, really telling the truth. We're getting ready to run out of time. And I wanted to ask Roberta, and I wanted to ask you all about any upcoming projects, you know, your current or upcoming project that you're working on that you might want to name. Roberta, you spoke about being at Westminster on the 27th. Was there anything else that you and Marcel wanted to share?
No, that was the very next thing coming up this month. And these, of course, it's the challenges that men have put us together. They said, oh, that girl can really play piano. This one plays out. Oh, man, we ought to get all these women together. That's right. All these special women together. And so they gave me a call because they needed a lady drummer, and they wondered if I would do it. And I'm like, interested in the challenge and to see what will become of this conglomeration of individuals. I mean, we don't know each other, and we don't know where each other is coming from. That sense of core, that sense of knowing that comes when you're a group that's been together for a while.
What about you, Kenitra? Any you want to share about any current or upcoming projects that you are working on?
Well, I mentioned a few of them earlier. You know, the recording project we're starting with Hubert Laws, and those are things for the future. But I would just like to give a shout out to the DC Jazz Festival. They're celebrating their 10 years, and they have events that are going on now through the end of June. And you can find out about those from dcjazzfest.org, and it has a list of everything that's coming up. And along with that, I would just like to mention Sunny Sumter, who is, there again, a female, and she's the executive director of the DC Jazz Festival. So very smart young lady. Very business savvy, and she, I think, does a really good job at making sure that she gives women a prominent role in the DC Jazz Festival.
She actually is. I had an opportunity to interview her when we were on Champlain Street about the festival. So, Kenitra, thank you so much for being a part of this interview and sharing with us this morning. We appreciate that greatly. We want you to have a beautiful day and a beautiful upcoming weekend.
Thank you so much. You too.
And Roberta and Marcella, it has been my pleasure to get to talk with the, you know, Fritz and the Duchess.
Thank you.
You know, and so I look forward to it. I hope to make it to down there on the 27th.
Yes. Friday the 27th.
Yeah. So we're gonna get out of here. As always, say raise your voice for yourself. Raise your voice on behalf of someone who has not yet found their voice, and we're going to go out hopefully with just a little snippet from Fritz and the Duchess and a little snippet from Afro Blue. And all of you, I'll be with you next week. Take care.
I've got to keep on pushing. I can't stop now. Move up a little higher, higher, oh yeah. Some way, somehow. Now I've got my strength, and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing.
Listening to the just completed Public Affairs or News program. As a listener-sponsored community radio station, WPFW appreciates your feedback, whether favorable or otherwise. To provide your feedback, even if it is regarding one of our many music programs, simply email us at info@wpfw.org. That's info@wpfw.org. Thanks.
I've got my strength, and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing. Now look, 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 now look yonder. Ooh, yeah. Now what is that I see? A great big stone wall. Keep on pushing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Keep on pushing. Keep on pushing. Hallelujah.
You gotta keep